Dexter's boy, Dexter.
He's betrothed to Aileen.
To Aileen's anchor shore.
And the pride of his sexes.
Of his sexes to be next to.
At the feast on the green.
On the green, oh be sure.
And the pride of his sexes. Of his sexes to be next to. At the feast on the green. On the green, oh be sure. We call.
Why this strange depression? The village rings with seasonable joy because the young and amiable Alexis, heir to the great Sir Marmaduke Poindexter, is plighted to Aileen, the only daughter of Annabella. Lady Sangazure, you alone are sad and out of spirits. What is the reason? Speak, my daughter, speak.
And then from white to red.
about it. Do not fear. I too have loved, but that was long ago. Who is the object of your young affections?
Hush, mother, he is here.
A reverend vicar.
Oh, pity me, my heart is almost broken.
My child, take heart. To such an union, I shall not offer any opposition. Take him, he's yours. May you and he be happy.
But, mother dear, he is not yours to give.
That's true, indeed.
He might object.
He might. But come, take heart. I'll probe him on the subject. Be comforted. Leave this affair to me.
Thank you. Bartlett. I'm glad to see you. And your little daughter, Constance. Why, she is quite a young lady, I must declare.
Oh, Mother, I cannot speak to him.
Yes, Reverend Sir. She is nearly 18 and as good a girl as ever stepped. Ah, sir, I'm afraid I shall soon lose her.
Oh, my dear, you pain me very much. Is she delicate?
Oh, no, sir, I don't mean that. But young girls look to get married.
Oh, I take you to be sure, Mrs. Bartlett. But there's plenty of time for that. 4 or 5 years hence, Miss Bartlett. 4 or 5 years hence. But when the time does come, I shall have much pleasure in marrying her myself. To some strapping young fellow in her own rank of life.
He does not love me.
I have often wondered, Reverend Sir, if you'll excuse the liberty, that you have never married.
Be still, my fluttering heart.
A clergyman's wife does so much good in a village. Besides that, you are not as young as you were. Soon you will want someone to nurse you and look after your little comforts.
Mrs. Bartlett, there is much truth in what you say. I am indeed getting on in years, and a helpmate would cheer me in my declining days. Time was when it might have been, but I've left it too long. I'm an old fogey now, am I not, my dear? A very old fogey. No, Mrs. Bartlett, my mind is quite made up. I shall live and die a solitary old bachelor.
Oh, Mother, Mother! Come, come, dear one, and don't fret. At a more fitting time, we will try again. We will try again.
Oh. Poor girl, I'm afraid she has something on her mind. She is rather comely. Time was when this old heart of mine would have throbbed double time at the sight of such a fairy form. But tush, I'm puling. Oh. Ah, the young Alexis with his proud and happy father. Let me dry this telltale tear. Sir Marmaduke, my dear good friend Alexis, on this most happy, most auspicious plighting, permit me as a true old friend to tender my very best congratulations.
Sir, you are most obliging. Dr. Daly, my dear old tutor, and my valued pastor, I thank you from the bottom of my heart.
May fortune bless you. May the middle distance of your young life be as pleasant as the foreground, the joyous foreground. And when you have reached it, may that which now is in the far-off horizon, but which will then be in the middle distance, in fruitful promise, be exceeded only by that which will have opened in the meantime into a new and glorious horizon.
Oh, dear sir, that is an excellent example of an old school of stately compliment to which I have through life been much addicted. Would you oblige me with a copy of it in a clerkly manuscript that I
myself may use it upon appropriate occasion.
Sir, you shall have a fairly written copy. Our soul has sunk into his western slumbers.
Come, come, Alexis. Your fiancé will be here in 5 minutes. Rouse yourself to receive her.
Oh, rapture!
Yes, you are a fortunate young fellow, and I will not disguise from you that this union with the House of Sangajur realizes my fondest wishes. Aileen is rich, and she comes of a sufficiently old family, for she is the 7037th in direct descent from Helen of Troy. True, true. There was a blot on the escutcheon of that lady. That affair with Paris. But where is the family other than my own in which there is no flaw? No, you are a lucky fellow, sir. A very lucky fellow.
Father, I am welling over with limpid joy. No sicklying taint of sorrow overlies the lucid lake of liquid love upon which, hand in hand, Aileen and I are to float into eternity.
Alexis, I desire that of your love for this young lady, you do not speak so openly. You're always singing ballads in praise of her beauty, and you expect the very menials who wait behind your chair to chorus your ecstasies. It is not delicate.
But father, a man who loves as I love...
Pooh-pooh, sir! 50 years ago, I madly loved your future mother-in-law, the Lady Sangajur. And I had every reason to believe she returned my love. But were we guilty of the indelicacy of publicly rushing into each other's arms with, oh, my adored one, beloved boy, ecstatic rapture, unmingled joy, which seems to be the modern fashion of lovemaking? No, it was. Madam, I trust you are in the enjoyment of good health. Oh, sir, you are vastly polite. I protest, I am mighty well. And so forth. Much more delicate, much more respectful. But see, Aileen approaches. Let us retire. Let us retire that she may compose herself for the interesting ceremony in which she is to play so important a part.
With voice, let us welcome the spirit.
By maddening in action, I find some satisfaction in apostrophe like this. Sang as your immortal, sang as your divine. Welcome to my portal, angel, oh, be mine. Immortal, divine, angel, oh, be mine. Irresistible, incentive, bids me humbly kiss your hand. I'm your servant, most attentive, most attentive to command.
greatly for your graceful courtesy. Compliment more truly knightly never yet was paid to me. Chivalry's an ingredient sadly lacking in our land. Sir, I am your most obedient, most obedient to command. Oh, while without a reason, and without a nation to endure, where love and season, no occasion do I miss. Goaded to distraction, by maddening inaction, I find some satisfaction in a prosody like this. Marmaduke, Mort, Marmaduke divine, take me to thy part. Loved one, oh, be mine, immortal, divine. Loved one, oh, be mine.
Why with adoration, mad with fascination, to endure my lamentation, no occasion do I miss. Why with adoration, to endure my lamentation, no occasion do I miss. I'm your servant, most attentive.
Oh,
star, endure my lamentation, no occasion do I miss. Why with adoration, yes, a man with fascination, to indulge my lamentation, no occasion do I miss. Your most obedient. Your most obedient to command.
For signing the contract has been drafted as agreed.
All is prepared for sealing and for signing. The contract has been drafted as agreed.
Approach the table, O ye lovers pining, with hand and seal, come execute the deed.
Approach the table,
I deliver it, I deliver it, as my act and deed.
I deliver it, I deliver it, as my act and deed.
See, they sign without a quiver it, then to still proceed. They deliver it, as their act and deed. They deliver it, they deliver it.
No doubt. Oh, that the world can be persuaded of the truth of that maxim. Oh, that the world would break down the artificial barriers of rank, wealth, education, age, beauty, habits, taste, and and recognize the glorious principle that in marriage alone can be found the panacea for every ill.
Continue to preach that sweet doctrine and you will succeed, oh, evangel of true happiness.
I hope so, but as yet the cause progresses but slowly. Still, I've made some converts to the principle that men and women should be coupled in matrimony without distinction of rank. I have lectured at mechanics institutes, and the mechanics were unanimous in favor of my views. I have preached at workhouses and beer shops and lunatic asylums, and they were all enthusiastic. I have addressed navvies on the advantages that would accrue to them if they married wealthy women of rank, and not a navvy dissented.
Noble fellows, and yet, some hold that the uneducated classes are not open to argument. Ooh, what do the countesses say?
Why, at present it can't be denied that the aristocracy hold aloof.
Ah, the working man is the true intelligence after all.
He is a noble creature when he is quite sober. Yes, Eline, true happiness comes of true love, and true love should be independent of external influences. It should live by itself and upon itself. Love should live for love alone.
Love feeds on many kinds of food, I know. Some love for rank and some for duty. Some give their hearts away for empty shore, and others look for youth and beauty. To love for money all the world is prone. Some love themselves and live alone. Give me the love that lasts for love alone. I love that love, I love it only. I love that love, I love it only. Give me the love that lasts for love alone. I love that love, I love it. What man for any other joy can thus, whose loving wife adores him duly? Want, misery, and care can do the worst, if loving woman loves you truly. A lover's thoughts are ever with his own, none truly loved is ever lonely. Give me the love that lasts for love alone. I love that love, I love it only. I love that love, I love it only. Give me the love that lasts for love alone. I love that love, I love it only.
Yes, Aline, and I intend to take a desperate step in support of them. Have you heard of the firm of J.W. Wells and Company? The old established family sorcerers? In St. Mary's?
I have seen their advertisement.
They haven't been to the filtra, which, if report is to be believed, is simply infallible. I intend to distribute this filter among the inhabitants of this village. And within 12 hours of my doing so, there will not be an adult in the place who will not have learnt the secret of pure and lasting happiness. What do you say to that?
Well, of course, dear. A filter is a very useful thing in a house, but I still don't quite see how it is the sort of thing that places its possessor on the very pinnacle of earthly joy.
Aileen, you misunderstand me. I didn't say a filter. I said a filter.
You don't mean a love potion.
On the contrary, I do mean a love potion.
Oh, Alexis, I don't think it would be right. I don't indeed. And then, a real magician? It would be downright wicked.
Aileen, is it not laudable to steep the entire village up to its lips in love and to couple them in matrimony without distinction of age, rank, or fortune?
Unquestionably.
Then, unpleasant as it must be to have recourse to supernatural aid, I must nevertheless pocket my aversion in deference to the great and good end I have in view. Hercules?
Yes, sir?
Is Mr. Wells there?
He's in the tent, sir, refreshing.
Ask him to be so good as to step this way.
Yes, sir.
Oh, Alexis, a real sorcerer? I should be frightened to death.
I trust that my Aileen will not yield to fear while the strong right arm of her Alexis is here to protect her.
Oh, it's nonsense, dear, to talk of you protecting me with your strong right arm in face of the fact that this family sorcerer could change me into a guinea pig before you could turn round.
He could change you into a guinea pig, no doubt. But it is most unlikely that he would do so. It is a most respectable firm, and he would never be guilty of so untradesmanlike an act.
No, good day, sir.
Good day. I believe you are a sorcerer?
Yes, sir. We practice necromancy in all its branches. We've a choice assortment of wishing caps, divining rods, amulets, charms, and counter charms. We can cast your nativity to low figure, and we have a horoscope at 3 and 6 that we can guarantee. Our Buddha chests, each containing a patent hag who comes forth and prophesies disasters with spring complete, are strongly recommended. Our Aladdin lamps are very chaste, and our prophetic tablets foretelling everything from a change in ministry down to a rise in unified are much inquired for. Our penny curse, one of the cheapest things in the trade, is considered infallible. We do have some very superior blessings as well, but, well, they're very little asked for. We've only sold one since Christmas to a gentleman who bought it to send to his mother-in-law, but it turned out he was afflicted in the head, and it's since been returned on our hands. But our sale of penny curses, especially on Saturday nights, is tremendous. We can't turn them out fast enough. My name is John Wellington Wells. I'm a dealer in magic and spells, in blessings and curses and ever-filled purses, in prophecies, witches, and nails. If you want a proud fool to make tracks, if you'd melt a rich uncle in wax, you've but to look in on our resident gin number 70 Simmeriax. We've a first-rate assortment of magic, and for raising a posthumous shade, with effects either comic or tragic, there's no cheaper house of the trade. Love filled with quantities of it, and for knowledge if anyone burns, we're keeping a very small profit, a profit who brings us unbounded returns. For he can prophesy with the week of his IP for security into futurity, sum up your history, clear up a mystery, humor proclivity, for nativity, for nativity. He has answers oracular, bogey spectacular, tetrapods tragical, mirror so magical, facts astronomical, solemn or comical, and if you want it, he makes a reduction on taking the quantity. Oh! If anyone anything lacks, he'll find it already in stacks, if he'd only look in on our resident gin number 70 Severiax.
Can raise you hosts of ghosts, and that without reflector, and creepy things with wings, and gaunt and grisly specters. Ooh. He can fill you crowds of shrouds, and horrify you vastly. He can rack your brains with chains, and gibberings grim and ghastly.
Then if you planity changes organity with an urbanity full of satanity, vexes humanity with an inanity fatal to vanity, driving your foes to the verge of insanity. Barring tautology, endemonology, electrobiology, mystic nosology, spirit philology, high-class astrology, such as ethnology, isn't the man to require an apology. Oh! My name is John Wellington Wells. I'm a dealer in magic and spells, in blessings and curses and ever-filled purses, in prophecies, witches and nails. And if anyone anything lacks, he'll find it already in stacks, if he'd only look in on our resident gin number 70 Simmeriacs.
Sent for you to consult you on a very important matter. I believe you advertise a patent oxyhydrogen love at first sight filter.
Sir, it is our leading article.
Now I would like to know if you can confidently guarantee it is possessing all of the qualities you claim for it in your advertisement.
Sir, we are not in the habit of puffing our goods. Ours is an old, established house with a large family connection, and every assurance held out in the advertisement is fully realized.
Alexis, don't offend him. He will change us into something dreadful. I know he will.
I am anxious from purely philanthropical motives to distribute this filter secretly among the inhabitants of this village. I shall, of course, require a quantity now. How do you sell it?
Oh, in buying a quantity, sir, I should advise you in taking it in the wood and drawing it off as you happen to want it. We have it in 4.5 and 9 gallon casks. Also in pipes and hogsheads for laying down, and we deduct, 10% from prompt cash.
I should mention that I am a member of the Army and Navy stores.
Well, in that case, we deduct 25%.
Good. Eileen, the villagers will assemble to carouse here in a few minutes. Go and fetch the teapot.
But Alexis!
My dear, you must obey me. Go and fetch the teapot.
I am sure Dr. Daly would disapprove of it.
And how soon until it takes effect?
Oh, in, 12 hours. Whoever drinks of it, falls asleep for that time and, upon waking, falls in love, as a matter of course, with the first lady he sees, who is also tasting it, and his affection is at once returned. One trial will prove the fact.
Good. Then, Mr. Wells, I shall feel obliged if you will at once pour as much filter into this teapot as will suffice to affect the entire village.
Oh, bless me. Alexis, many of the villagers are married people.
Madam, this filter is compounded on the strictest principles. On married people, it has no effect whatever. But are you quite certain that you have nerve enough to carry you through the fearful ordeal?
In the good cause, I fear nothing.
Very good, then. Let us proceed at once. To the incantation! Sprites of earth and air, fiends of flame and fire, demon souls, come here in shoals, this dreadful deed inspire. Appear! Appear! Appear!
Good Master, we are here!
Noisome hags of night, imps of deadly shade, pallid ghosts, arise in hosts and lend me all your aid. Appear, appear, appear!
Hark, hark, they assemble, these fiends of the night.
Oh, Alexis, I tremble, seek safety in flight.
given the wings of long with flying innocence.
Poison bags, discharge your loathsome load! Flame and fire, unholy choir, belch forth your venom toad! Ye demons fell with yelp and yell, shed curses far afield! Days of night, your filthy blight, in noisome plenty. Number one.
It is done.
Number two.
One too few.
Number three.
Set us free, set us free.
Where the fire of the silver strand is at full in air we sail.
But enjoy yourselves, I pray. Eat, I, and drink. Be merry, I implore ye. For once, let thought, let folly rule the day. Eat, drink, and be gay. Banish all worry and sorrow. Laugh gaily today. Weep if you're sorry tomorrow. Come, pass the cup round. I will go bail for the liquor. It's strong, I'll be bound. For it was brewed by the vicar. It's strong, I'll be bound. For it was brewed by the vicar.
None so knowing you see. A brewing a jar of tea. Ha 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 ha. A brings a jar of tea.
drink. All thoughts unheeding, the tea comes clink. They are exceeding, their hearts will melt in half an hour. It will be felt the potion's power. It will be felt the potion's power. The potion's power.
Pain, trouble, and care. Misery, heartache, and worry. Quick, out of your lair. Get your thorn in a hurry. Toil, sorrow, and blood. Fly away quicker and quicker. Three spoons to the pot. That is the brew of your vicar. Three spoons to the pot. That is the brew of your vicar.
None so sorry as he. And brewing a jorum of tea. Ha 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 ha. A brisk jorum of
Oh.
illusion that a tale's not in the eyes. The tale's
Tis 12, I think, and at this mystic hour, the magic drink should manifest his power.
Stay, my father is not here.
And pray, where is my mother, dear?
I did not think it meet to see a dame of lengthy pedigree, a baronet and KCB, a doctor of divinity, and that respectable QC, all fast asleep al frescoli. And so I had them carried home and put to bed respectably. And put to bed respectably. I trust my conduct earns your approbation.
Sir, you watch it with discrimination and shown more delicate appreciation than we expect in persons of your station.
Yes,
in shown more delicate appreciation
than they expect in persons of your station. But soft, they waken one by one. The spell has worked, the deed is done. I would suggest that we retire while of the housemaid lights a kitchen fire.
While of the housemaid lights a kitchen fire.
Thank you. me, I am doing, a sleeping out just when the dew's to rise.
Why, that's the very way you're out to ruin, and don't seem quite respectable likewise.
Hey, that's you, only think of that now.
What may you be at now? Tell me, do.
Hey, what a nose, and hey, what eyes, miss. Lips like a rose, and cheeks like wise, miss.
I tell you true, which I never done, sir. I like you, as I never like none, sir.
Hey, what I do, like. Marry me, I'll dig for you and break for you.
If you'll marry me, I'll scrub for you and make for you.
If you'll marry me, all others I'll forsake for you.
All this will I do if you marry me. If you'll marry me, I'll cook for you and brew for you.
If you'll marry me, I'll give you some of these for you.
If you'll marry me, I'll take you in and do for you. All this will I do.
Dressed and 67 years.
time, but for the rest, I did not hear it clearly.
You very well know that she loves you dearly.
Oh joy, oh joy, the charm works well, and all are now united.
The blind young boy obeys the spell, their troth they all have plighted. Little joy, no words can tell how my poor heart has plighted. They'll soon employ a marriage bell to say that we're united. I do confess an anxious care my humble spirit vexes, and none to blessings so for rare of their beloved Alexis. Oh, their Alexis.
Oh, Lord, a time, oh, times, tell that sight of mine united. Oh, Lord,
assorted unions. The miserly wife will check the reckless expenditure of her too frivolous consort. The wealthy husband will shower innumerable bounties on his penniless bride. And the young and lively spouse will cheer the declining days of her aged partner with comic songs unceasing.
What a delightful prospect for him!
But one thing remains to be done that my happiness be complete. We must drink the filter ourselves, so that I may be assured of your love forever and ever.
Oh. Alexis, do you doubt me? Is it necessary that a love such as ours should be secured by artificial means? Oh, no, no, no!
My dear Eileen, time works terrible changes, and I wish to place our love beyond the chance of change.
Alexis, it is already far beyond that chance. Have faith in me, for my love can never, never change.
Then you absolutely refuse?
I do. If you cannot trust me, you have no right to love me. No right to be loved by me.
Enough, Aileen. I shall know how to interpret this refusal.
Thou hast the power thy vaunted love to sanctify all doubt above, despite the gathering shade, to make that love of thine so sure that come what may it must endure till time itself shall fade. Thy love is but a flower that fades within the hour. If such thy love for shame, call it by other name. Thy love is but a flower that fades within the hour. If such thy love for shame, call it by other name. It is not love, it is not love. Thine is the power and thine alone to to place me on so proud a throne that kings might envy me. A priceless throne of love untold, more rare than all in pearl and gold. But no, no, thou wouldst be free. Such love is like the rare that dies within not air. If such thy love for shame, call it by other name. Such love is like the rare that dies within not air. If such thy love for shame, call it by other name. It is not love, it is.
It is very singular. It has overthrown all my calculations. It is distinctly opposed to the doctrine of averages. I cannot understand it.
Dear Dr. Daly, what has puzzled you?
My dear, this village has not hitherto been addicted to marrying and giving in marriage. Hitherto, the youths of this village have not been enterprising, and the maidens have been distinctly coy. Judge then my surprise when I tell you that just now the village came to me in a body and implored me to join them in matrimony with as little delay as possible. Even your excellent father has hinted to me that before very long it is not unlikely that he may also change his condition.
Oh, Alexis, do you hear that? Are you not delighted?
Yes, I confess that a union between your mother and my father would be a happy circumstance indeed. My dear sir, the news that you bring us is very gratifying.
Still, in my eyes, it is has its melancholy side. All this universal marrying recalls the happy days. Now, alas, gone forever, when I myself might have been but tush, I'm puling. I am too old to marry. And yet, within the last half hour, I've greatly yearned for companionship. I've never remarked it before, but the young maidens of this village of very calmly. So likewise, the middle-aged. Also the elderly. All are comely. And all are engaged.
Oh, here comes your father.
Mrs. Podlett?
Mrs. Podlett?
Dr. Daly, give me joy! Alexis, my dear boy, you will, I am sure, be pleased to hear that my declining days
are not unlikely to be solaced by the companionship of this good, virtuous, and amiable woman.
My dear father, this is not altogether what I expected. I'm certainly taken somewhat by surprise. Still, it should hardly be necessary to assure you that any wife of yours is a mother of mine. This is not as I could have wished it.
Oh, sir, I entreat your forgiveness. I am aware that socially I am not everything that could be desired, nor am I blessed with an abundance of worldly goods. But I can still confer upon your estimable father the great and precious dowry of a true, tender, and loving heart.
I do not question it. After all, a faithful love is the true source of every earthly joy.
Oh, I knew my boy would not fault his dear father for acting on the impulse of a heart which has never yet misled him. Zora is not what the world calls beautiful.
Still, she is comely. Distinctly comely.
Zora is very good and clean and honest and is quite sober in her habits. And that is worth far more than beauty, my dear Sir Marmaduke.
Yes. Beauty shall die and perish, but personal cleanliness is practically undying, for it can be renewed whenever it discovers symptoms of decay. My dear Sir Marmaduke, I heartily congratulate you all. Oh, rejoice that is decided. Happy now will be his life. For my father is provided with a true and tender wife.
She will tend him, nurse him, mend him, air his bed and dry his tears. Bless the thoughtful face that sent him such a wife to soothe his years.
No young giddy, thoughtless maiden, full of graces and tears, but a sober widow laden with the weight of 50 years.
No high-born exact beauty, blazing like a chamber song, but a wife will do her duty as that duty should be done.
She will tend him, nurse him, mend him, air his linen, dry his tears. Bless the thoughtful face that sent him such a wife to soothe his years.
I'm no sir-teeming and giddy, percy such as them are bound, but a clean and tidy witty will be known for miles around.
All the village now have mated, and are happy as can be. I to live alone and sated, no one left to marry me.
No one's left to marry him. She will tend him, nurse him, mend him, fare his linen, dry his tears. Bless the thoughtful face that sent him such a wife to soothe his years.
Bless the thoughtful face that sent him such a wife to soothe his years.
Thank you.
I have wrought much evil with my spells, and ill I can't undo. This is too bad of you, J.W. Wells. What wrong have they done you? And see, another lovelorn lady comes. Alas, poor stricken dame. A gentle pensiveness her life benumbs, and mine alone the blame.
Alas, a me, and well a day, I sigh for love, and well I may, for I am very old and gray. But stay, what is this fairy form I see before me?
Oh, horrible, she's going to adore me. This last catastrophe is overpowering.
Why do you glare at me with visage lowering? For pity's sake, recoil not thus from me.
My lady, leave me. This may never be. Hate me, I drop my H's av through life.
Love me, I'll drop them too.
Hate me, I always eat peas with a knife.
Love me, I'll eat like you.
Hate me, I often roll down one tree hill.
Love me, I'll meet you there.
Hate me, I sometimes go to Rocheville.
Love me, that joy I'll share. My prejudice and forever.
Hate me, that's not enough.
Love me, I'll come and help you in the shop.
Hate me, the life is rough.
Love me, my grammar I will all forswear.
Hate me, abjure my lot. They'll suit you not. At what I'm going to say, be not enraged. I may not love you, for I am engaged.
Engaged, engaged.
Engaged to a maiden fair with bright brown hair and a sweet and simple smile, who waits for me by the sounding sea on a South Pacific isle. A lie, no maiden waits me there.
She has a bright brown hair.
A lie, no maiden smiles on me.
By the sounding sea, Oh, agony, rage, despair, the maiden has wiped upon her, and mine is as white as snow. False man, it will be your fault if I go to my mother and mother and marry my life along. Whoa!
Oh, agony, rage, despair, oh, where will this end? Oh, where I should very much like to know. It will certainly be my fault if she goes to a family vault to bury a lifelong woe.
It will certainly be my fault
if she goes to a family vault.
The family vault,
the vault,
the family vault,
the family vault, the family vault,
the family vault,
the family vault,
the family vault,
the family vault,
the family vault,
the family vault,
the
family vault,
the
family vault,
the family vault.
Yes, the
family vault.
Alexis, doubt me not, my loved one. See, thine uttered will is sovereign law to me.
my voice is sad and low, and with timid step I go. For with load of love or laden, I inquire of every maiden, will you wed me, little lady? Will you be my guarded shady? Little lady answers no, no, no. Thank you for your kindly proffer, good your heart and full your offer. Yet I must decline your offer, I'm engaged to so-and-so. So-and-so, so-and-so. So-and-so, so-and-so. She's engaged to so-and-so. What are old young hearts to fill it? What a worker on the steelage. Every maiden in the village is engaged to so-and-so. So-and-so, so-and-so. So-and-so, so-and-so. All's engaged to so-and-so.
Rather than blood and water, why is the larger one so? Why does he matter? The glory of water, why is the larger one so?
Oh, why is the she matter? The glory of water, why is the larger one so?
prepare for sad surprises. My love Aileen despises. No thought of sorrow shames her, for another lover claims her. Be his, false girl, for better or for worse. But ere you leave me in a lover's curse,
held, be just. This poor child drank the philtre at your instance. She ran off to meet you, but most unhappily met me instead. As you administered the potion to both of us, the result was inevitable. But fear nothing from me. I will be no man's rival. I shall quit the country at once and bury my sorrow in the congenial gloom of a colonial bishopric.
My excellent old friend. But, Mr. Wells, what? What is to be done?
I do not know. And yet, there may be one means by which the spell's effects may be removed.
Name it! Name it!
Or you, or I, must yield his life up to Ahrimanes! I would rather it be you. I should have no hesitation in sacrificing my life for yours, but we take stock next week, and it wouldn't be fair on the company.
True. Well, I am ready.
No, no, Alexis, it must not be! Oh. Mr. Wells, if he must die so that all may be restored to their old loves, then what is to become of me? I should be left out in the cold. With no love to be restored to.
Oh, true. I did not think of that. Oh, my friends, I appeal to you. I leave the decision in your hands. Or I, or he, must die. Which shall it be? Reply.
Die thou, thou art the cause of all offending.
Die thou, you bow to this decree unbending.
Die thou, die thou, die thou.
So be it, I submit my fate. Popular opinion, thus I yield. Be happy, all. Leave me to my despair. I go, it matters not with whom. Oh.
All of you, at least we'll crown our rapture with another feast.
Now to the banquet we press, now for the eggs and the ham, now for the mustard and cress, now for the strawberry jam. Now for the tea of our host, now for the rollicking band,
Now for the muffin and toast, and now for the gay Sally Lunn. Now for the muffin and toast, and now for the gay Sally Lunn.
The eggs and the ham and the strawberry jam, the barking bun and the gay Sally Lunn. The eggs and the ham and the strawberry jam, the barking bun and the gay Sally Lunn. The eggs and the ham and the strawberry jam, and the rollicking bun. The rollicking bun and the gay Sally Lunn, and the strawberry jam.
Jam!
Bun!
Bun!
Oh, the strawberry, strawberry jam!
Thank you.